Hi, everybody. Great to be here with my second session today, comparison of streaming analytics frameworks and what to do with that in the real world. If you have attended my first talk about machine learning and how to apply that to real-time processing, it's definitely related and maybe 10% overlapping, but most of this is new content, even if you have attended the other session. So let's take a look at the agenda for this session. First, again, a perspective from the use cases, and then I will introduce streaming analytics, what do we mean with that, and then an overview about the different open source frameworks in the market and products and cloud services and so on. So that's really a perfect session if you have not heard much about that, and there are other sessions afterwards about Apache Flink and Apache Apex and so on, where you can learn much more about the detail. And then I will also talk a little bit about how this is related to other big data components, and in the end show how to realize that in a real-world project. So let's begin again with a little bit of motivation. Why do we see more and more stream processing? And that's the same slide I've used in my machine learning talk, because it's really relevant for both. And the key is really to act on critical business moments, that when you want to process on new events in real time while the data is hot. And you can apply machine learning there in some use cases, but still the concept is the same, that you continuously evaluate streams of incoming data and correlate the events, aggregate them, and do what makes sense there. There's different use cases in any kind of industries, like fraud detection for bank transactions, for example. Or you can think about making an offer to a customer before he leaves the store. So here it's really important to do that in real time before he has left the store, because then he will go to another store and buy it there. Or the same for longer running processes like predictive maintenance. If you want to replace a machine, so you have to continuously watch the streams of events to decide if you want to replace that. And I will also use in the live demo later the same use case as I showed before, a little bit from a different perspective of how you implement such a stream process. And that is smart manufacturing. And the business case here was that the customer had an issue, and for every 1% increase in shipped product, so if he improves it, they can make 11 million more in profit. So in the other case said, they simply want to reduce the cost to make more money with that. And the use case behind that is in manufacturing and the assembly lines, where by now they in the end decided by gut feeling how to decide how to scrap parts. So you have different stations, and every station costs you a lot of money, and the part is then moved to the next station and so on, and sometimes you have to put it back to the other station again and do rework. And you want to decide when to scrap a part, and for doing that you have to continuously analyze these events to make these decisions. And then you also have a live UI on top of that to really that the human can also monitor and watch that and proactively act if a machine breaks, so that you can stop it or send a mechanic or something like this. That's basically the idea behind streaming analytics and the use cases in all the different industries. And so let's talk a little bit more about what is streaming analytics. And by the way, if you Google for that term and one more definition, it's sometimes also stream processing, or sometimes stream analytics, streaming analytics. There's a lot of different terms, but in the end, it really means that you want to process the data while it is in motion. And that's the key difference of streaming analytics compared to what you know from traditional data processing, where you have request-response model. If you use SOAP web services or REST or some other kind of request-response, where you ask for information and then there's some processing or information from the database and you get the response back. But the issue with that is that, as I've showed you in the use cases before, the event value decreases over time in many, many use cases. So when the fraud already happened, then it's too late. Or when the customer has already left the store, then it's too late to proactively cross-sell to him. And therefore, we are seeing more and more streaming analytics. So really analyzing the data while it is hot, while it is in motion. That's really the key difference. You do not do a request response every second or every 10 seconds or whatever time you want to need to do that. You continuously query the data, and that's the key difference and a really completely new concept. And when you start programming with that, it's also a different kind of thinking of how you realize your use cases. And the following slide will be shown more and more in this talk to compare the different frameworks and so on. And that's about the streaming analytics processing pipeline, which you need to implement. In the beginning, you have all these different streams, which are events, everyone, and you really usually parse them while, when they're coming in directly, so you, while the data is in motion, and that can be social feeds or sensor information or log analytics or whatever you want to analyze or even correlate different of these data sources. And then the first part is to ingest this information. This is typically done via some kind of messaging solution, so something like a JMS implementation or Apache Kafka, we see that more and more, these open source frameworks, or even proprietary solutions, which also work pretty well, of course. Or it can still be an API or some other kind of integration channel which you have there. But somehow you get the events in the streams, and these streams typically have some kind of timestamps, so they are immutable, they are events which happen somewhere, and then they flow in, and you do not change these anymore. These are events which happen and then they are just analyzed and correlated. And the second step then is the pre-processing. That's some kind of integration or ETL or how you want to call it. So you change the data and adapt it in a way that you can process it further and correlate it. So often in these use cases, you have to analyze and correlate different data sources, and they have different structure and different data types, often different technologies, and you have to bring that to the right data shape to process them afterwards, and therefore you transform it or you filter it out if you only want to process relevant information. So for Internet of Things and manufacturing use cases, for example, or if you think about cars which have more and more sensors, you do not need to process all the data, but maybe only the important one and filter before. And then the next step is the streaming analytics. That's the, let's say, powerful part and the interesting part, which also I focus most time in this talk. And that's really where you correlate the different events, because that's where you add the value. And I've talked about that in the other talk, that first, of course, you have to find these insights in historical data, because it's nice to be able to correlate different events, and you can do something with that, but first you have to know what you want to do. You have to analyze historical data to find out why did the fraud happen, right? What's the pattern for that, or the insight? Or what can you cross-sell to a specific customer, what is he interested in? And then afterwards, when you know these patterns, you implement it here in this context, and here you use things like contextual rules, really context-specific rules per specific customer or per specific machine. And you use things like sliding windows and patterns, but also more powerful things. And that was the part of my last talk 2 hours ago, to apply machine learning and analytic models within this step of streaming analytics here. To every single event, you apply this model then. And finally, when you have done all this analytics continuously on real-time data, then you can send it to the output. The output can be a live UI where some human interacts with that, or you can send automatic alerts, or you can send it to a database or data warehouse, or whatever you want to do with the data. And we will see this slide more and more through this talk, because this is really the key parts of streaming analytics when you want to implement that in your project. And depending on if you want to use open source frameworks or cloud services or products, it also differs on how many different frameworks you want to use. And I want to focus on that in a minute. And therefore, first, let's talk about again about the stream pre-processing part. That's in the end the data pipeline where you integrate the stuff. You could call it some kind of extract transform load, but it is in real time. That's the key difference also. So you really process the data while it is in motion and not via request response, like in batch processing of classical ETL as you did in the past for a data warehouse, for example. And then in the second part, as I said, you analyze the data. And here the key difference again, and I really want to highlight that, is that you do not request response things, but you use Windows. And Windows are a completely different programming model, and also the implementation and operations you use in your frameworks are different, because you have to think in another way around it. So the easiest one is the fixed Windows, where all Windows have the same attribute or time slot or whatever you want to use here. This can be by tuple or by second or whatever you want to configure in your use case. And then you have the sliding windows. That's the one which are even more interesting, where you continuously query data. Let's say you start in second zero and you want to monitor 5 seconds, and you slide that. So then you go from 1 second to 6 seconds, from 2 seconds to 7, and this way you continuously analyze the data. Before it is stored in the database, without request response, continuously monitor this data. And that's what the frameworks are built for, which I will show you in a minute. Or you even have sessions, for example, user sessions when they are browsing in a web browser, and these sessions are completely different all the time. So here you do not have a definition like every window is 5 seconds or so, but here in the end the user or the machine depends on how long a session is, and this is completely different. Basically, when we talk about streaming analytics or stream processing, it's about machine-machine communication, so automation. You have a lot of events, usually hundreds, thousands, even millions of events, and often with fast processing time, and you continuously monitor them. But what we see more and more in most customer use cases and most industries is that in many situations, the human shall have the last situation, the last decision. So here it's really about understanding that even if it's streaming analytics, often it's about augmented intelligence to help the human make decisions. For example, to correlate all these events automatically, but then send the final alert or this final issue still to a live UI where the human can make the last decision. I usually give the example of predictive maintenance. We have that in airlines, for example, or in, at customers with oil platform. That's interesting. And there, when an alert pops up, and there is a model said that probably the following machine will break in the next 48 hours. And then you would say, okay, the probability, thanks to our machine learning model, is 80 or 90%, and though let's replace it before it breaks. But on the other side, these kind of parts are still very expensive. They can be 100,000 euro or even more. And therefore, still the human has to make the last decision. He again takes a look at the data in more detail, and then he decides if we want to replace the part in this example. From an architecture perspective, here you see different components. In this talk, really, I focus on the event processing or stream processing, streaming analytics part, however you want to call the term. That's the blue part in the screen, where you really get the inputs in, like sensors or like social media information or whatever else the stream is. And then you correlate that in real time to make a decision or to make a recommendation or something like this. And that combined with the live UI to augmented intelligence for the human. On the other side, I will talk about that shortly at the end, is the red part, where you find the patterns, actually. Because, as I said, before you want to implement patterns in real time, you first have to find that out. But that actually was my other talk, which I had before. And if you're interested more in that, you can also find the slides and video on YouTube. Let's now take a look at the market overview. And that's really the key of this talk, to show the different frameworks and products and so on, how you can realize streaming analytics. And before that, I have read a 451 research report a few days ago. It's from September 2016, so relatively up to date. And it says that streaming analytics, the market for that is growing. And that really shows that not just for commercial products, but also the open source frameworks, which we see a lot of talks at this conference here today and tomorrow. This, the demand for that is growing. And the reason for that is very simple. In the beginning, let's say 10 years ago, there were a few vendors with streaming analytics, and they built that only for financial trading. And therefore, that's this high performance and so on, but that was built that time for financial trading. And in the meantime, all of the banks had these tools, and then it was no more growing, this market. But now, with Internet of Things and all the connected devices, social media and big data and so, we see this growing market, and that's exactly the reason why the market is growing this much, because it's much, much more relevant to really act on critical business moments in real time. And that's the key difference and why the market is getting so much more traction, and also why, for example, the Hadoop vendors and so on are focusing much more now on these stream processing frameworks. In the past, as we also have heard in the keynote today, in the past, Hadoop was batch and MapReduce, and now they're focusing much more on real-time stories. And this real-time, this is in the end realized also on Hadoop or with Apache Spark and so on, with streaming analytics. And for that, now we have a lot of options to realize that. We have first the streaming concept, and then based on that, a lot of different frameworks and products. So, shortly for the concepts, I mean, the concepts, that's these things I just explained, like sliding windows and continuous queries. So, really the key differences compared to the classical programming model with request response. And there's a lot of interesting concepts, but let's be honest, we do not want to build these frameworks by ourselves. So, there are a lot of frameworks on the market, so I have never seen a customer so who built really that by themselves. Because if you do not have to buy a product, there are a lot of open source frameworks and so on. So, in my opinion, this doesn't make sense to implement these streaming analytics frameworks by yourself. And therefore, I see two different options which you can use. The one is the frameworks, which we will take a look at, and the other one is the products. The frameworks first, these have a lot of things implemented already for you. They have libraries for different languages like Java or Python, and they have a specific query language. And this query language is specifically for streaming analytics. Usually, it is very similar to SQL, or mostly compliant to SQL even, but it has a few key differences. For example, it has options for continuous queries and sliding windows, which are not available in SQL, because SQL, again, is request response. You do a query and get a response. You can do that every second or so, but you have to do it again and again. And the difference is streaming analytics continuously queries the data. The implementation is built for that, so it's completely different implementation under the hood which is running. And these technologies and frameworks are built for scaling out. Therefore, they are running usually on things like Apache Hadoop, for example, or in some cloud service. And they connect to all the different technologies. This can be messaging layers like MQTT or JMS, or other technologies, or even products or frameworks. Or, for example, we see a lot of that in the financial trading for market feeds, where you have direct connectors, for example. And they implement all of these features you need, like filtering, sorting, aggregating, and so on. And however, if you want to use the frameworks, you simply should be aware there's different ones. I will show you one example in a few minutes. You have to usually combine different frameworks. So if you want to use Apache Flink or Apache Spark Streaming, that's one part of the puzzle, if you remember the pipeline I've showed you. And therefore, let's first take a look at the first part of this pipeline of ingestion and pre-processing. So get the data and process it and transform it and filter and so on. That's the first part which you have to do. And for that, there's a few cool open source frameworks on the market. We have seen one in the keynote also, Apache NiFi. And there's other ones also open source, like StreamSets or a very new one is Cascade Writer. And as you see here in the screenshots, all of these have web UIs. And that's what I really like about that, because when you think about integrating a lot of different connectivity things, like Internet of Things, you have so many different devices, often completely different technologies, messaging protocols, programming languages. And with these graphical tools, you can have the connectivity to that, and then you can do the transformation and filtering. And this is really for ingestion, for getting the data from the devices or from the social feeds and so, and get that to the next step in the processing pipeline. And that's what they are built for and what they are great for. And then there is the second part, which is this analytics part. And this is the one which I think is the more interesting part, because here really this is about a new concept and a new thinking. Because the data ingestion is still, the thinking is the same. It's about integration, filter, transform, and so on, like you did before with batch, but now you do it in streaming. But the key difference now and the power of streaming analytics comes now with the event processing part, with the correlation of the events. And for that, I've shortly also shown that in my other talk, but here I will go into much more detail. You have a lot of frameworks and products on the market. So let's take a short look first at the frameworks. And framework, again, that in the end means coding. I do not mean this is good or bad. This is always trade-offs if you want to write code or not. And here you have available open source option. Here you see a lot of them. Like, I think later today is a talk about Apache Flink and also one about Apache Apex. There's Apache Spark Streaming, Apache Storm. Heron is the newcomer from Twitter, which they use now instead of Storm. So this is a growing space and a lot of different frameworks available. And on the other side, you also have cloud services with closed source offerings for these kind of things. And let's take a look at a few of them. Apache Storm is the one which is probably the oldest and most mature one. And this one also here, the screenshot shows the typical basics of these things. You build the different pipelines. As I showed you before, you do ingested data and then you correlate it here somehow. Apache Storm, for example, has the input stream, it's called Spout, and the output is the Bolt. And no matter which framework you use, probably it has different names and terms for that. So, but the concepts, and that's the key, is really always the same, and that's the important thing to understand. And if you want to build a Hello World with Storm, for example, you don't need to read the code. It's really just the key is you have different components, and everyone has an input and an output, and in the middle you do some activity, like streaming analytics correlation, or applying an analytic model to that. And that's done in the code, and then you run that and test that and debug that, in this case with Java or with any kind of API which is supported. On the other side, if you think about the cloud services, and all the big ones have this kind of stream processing as cloud service, like AWS with Kinesis, but also Microsoft and Google have similar offerings. And here the key difference is it's in the cloud, with all its pros and cons. And one of the pros, of course, here, as you see, it's pretty good integrated to all the other offerings of the vendor. So for example, with AWS, you can easily get your data out of S3 or into S3 and so and connect to Redshift data warehouse for storing it afterwards. And so that's pretty cool integration, and that's true for all these kind of cloud vendors. It's still a framework, so it's closed source and proprietary, but it's a framework, so you can see on the bottom that there is some kind of configuration which allows you getting started quickly, but the basic code for the correlation and event processing is still implementation. So this is done in the API which is provided in Java or Python or whatever the cloud service provides you. And that's the way you implement it here. You write the code and then you deploy it to the, in this case, Amazon service and run it there. And of course, the huge benefit of AWS, you can easily scale it out. That's one of the huge benefits of the public cloud providers, of course. On the other side, you always have to think about the trade-offs that you have to load all your data to the cloud. You might have light latency issues, privacy. I'm from Germany, that's a big issue there. So always simply think about the trade-offs of cloud and not cloud. So also what we heard a lot here is, and that's a, maybe a difference to other cloud services like a data storage. For stream processing, you need to have some good performance or so and some specific SLAs. And if you run it on-premise and configure the stuff by yourself, you can tune it easily. And if you use a cloud service, it's much tougher because they have their specific SLAs, and that's it. And therefore, again, it's pros and cons. You always have to trade that off. And the third one I want to talk about shortly is Apache Spark streaming. That's getting more and more hot. And the reason for that is not that Spark streaming, I think, is the best one, but the reason is that Apache Spark is getting so hot. So we see that in every Hadoop distribution. In the meantime, they are talking more about Spark than about Hadoop itself with HDSF and so on. And therefore, that's pretty cool because Apache Spark is a general data processing framework, and it allows a lot of things for machine learning and so on. And that's also what I talked in the talk before about, to build analytic models. And the great thing here is you can combine that with Spark streaming. And that's good if you want to do it all together, then you have, in the end, one big API for all of that. And that's the huge benefit of Spark streaming. And however, on the other side, Spark streaming, you have to know or understand is that it's more or less using micro batches. So it's not a real streaming solution where you process every single event by itself, like what it was built, thought the concept behind that. But here you use micro batches of a few streams and process them together. On the other side, you also have to say that often this is good enough. So it depends again on the use case. So this is definitely not a use case for financial trading, where it's really more about microseconds and not about milliseconds. But for many other use cases, it's absolutely fine if you have just micro batches. And they're also improving the engine these days, so it's getting even better. But for the most high performance requirements, Spark streaming is probably not the right one. But on the other side, as I said, and as you see here in one example, therefore the benefit is you have a core API in the end for Spark, and you leverage that for everything, for machine learning, for graph processing, and also for Spark streaming. And oops, this was the wrong button. So here for Spark Core, or for example, for Spark streaming, then here you see a few operations or methods which you have just for Spark streaming then, but you can combine that easily with the other ones. What I like about Spark also is that it's available as cloud service, so you can scale it out easily and getting started and so on with Databricks or Cubal or whatever. So there's a lot of cloud services available which you can use for that. And then the last one to mention here is Apache Flink. That's another, I would say, newcomer. I think it's there still for a few years available now, but contrary to the others, it's younger. And it looks very similar to Apache Spark and so on if you take a look at the architecture and components. But this one was really built for streaming first. And that's the key difference. As I told you, Apache Spark streaming is with micro batches, and this one was built from new with streaming first intention. And therefore, I think if you want to hear more details, there's a talk later about Apache Flink where they will definitely explain why Flink is there and why it exists. One challenge I see here in the meantime with all these open source frameworks, the number is growing and it's getting more and more. And nobody knows which one to use and so on. And so that might be a little bit too much in the meantime. And for that reason, again, there is another project again. So that's the good and the bad of open source. You have a lot of different options to choose. And then again, you get these super projects on top of that, which again integrate with the others on the bottom. Because, for example, here now you have Apache Beam. And Apache Beam was created. That was that you have, again, one unified programming model for all the different open source frameworks. And with this, you have one API, in this case, example, with Java and with Python, where you can write your stream processing code. And then it generates some code, and then you can run that in any kind of engine which implements this interface. Like, for example, Apache Flink again, or Apache Spark Streaming, or Cloud Dataflow from Google. That's one of the big supporters of Apache Beam these days. And so I don't know in the real world if you really want to use many different of these frameworks and how, where the differences is, but you have to evaluate that then by yourself. And so if we go back to this stream processing pipeline again, ingesting, pre-processing, streaming analytics, one example here now, how that is combined, I took that from Hortonworks website. Here they have built one example where they combine, for example, Apache NiFi for the ingestion, where you get it from the top from many different data sources, in the end often from the edge. If you think about Internet of Things, you have to connect somehow to the edge devices. Therefore, you also, in the meantime, have Apache MyNiFi, which is a small version of NiFi to deploy on the edge, which is more lightweight. And then you get the data in. That's the ingestion part with NiFi. And then you have Apache Kafka as messaging layer. And then finally, you have Apache Storm for the streaming analytics part. So here you simply see you have the puzzle, and you have three different components and three different frameworks for that. Which again, trade-off can be good or bad. It's separation of concerns, but it's also different frameworks which you have to think about and update and keep in production and so on. So always think about the trade-offs. And then on the other side, we have the products. That's the commercial products which are available for years because especially they emerged from the financial trading. So for example, we have a customer in New York. He's trading on the New York Stock Exchange with our TIBCO product. And they, a few years ago, moved from 1 kilometer away from the New York Stock Exchange to 0.5 kilometer from there. Because then it's even again, I don't know how many microseconds faster, and so they can do more trades and so on. So that's really high, crazy performance. So these are the engines which exist. And the key difference between now, if you want to use a framework or an engine, a product, the product has all the concepts of the framework, like Spark or Storm or whatever you want to think about. And in addition, it has a few features, like you have a visual coding, and you have just one tool instead of, like I showed you with the Hortonworks examples, many different components, like NiFi plus Storm plus Kafka and so on, you use all in one in the end. And you have some more features like simulation or live UI, which you do not have to build by yourself, and so on. And so for that, in the end, you have, as I said, all the one pipeline, you build it with one product then. That's the huge difference, I think, besides some others. And for that, then, you build a complete pipeline here with one product, again, from the architecture reference. One example here is IBM Streams, which is one of the most major on the market, I think. Also, the same story like TIBCO with financial trading, and now, of course, used in many other industries. Another one is the one, the company I work for, TIBCO Streambase. So that's just, again, different options. Other ones are, for example, software HCI Palma is very well known, or SAP has a streaming solution. So all the big software IT vendors, I would say, have some kind of streaming analytics. And the key difference of the product showing here to you, if one example is, this is an implementation of fraud detection, where you want to capture card activations per location. And simply here, the difference is about development also, that you develop it in a visual way. And what we get the feedback, of course, there I'm not really neutral because I work for such a vendor, is that our customers say that it's more productive because you can easily create it and also afterwards maintain it. So if you have to change the process in a few weeks, then it's easier to take a look at this UI instead of debugging the code or so. But again, that's trade-offs and decide by yourself. Other features, I can show you the feed simulation in a minute in the live demo. That's also great. You can use the historical data and send the feeds in and test it and correlate it. And it's simply a different way of programming than writing some kind of source code. That's in the end the difference from the development perspective. And then the third part, so no matter if you want to use a framework or a product, you need some kind of augmented intelligence for the humans usually. That's really a key part of streaming analytics, and almost all projects we do with customers, I really see in most cases, they want a human to make the most important decision still. And for that, you have some kind of live UI. And the key difference here is that this live UI also has to be built on top of the streaming engine. And that's really the key difference. So you do not build just a JavaScript API where you send some events in, but it really has to be a continuous querying under the hood. And that's very important. And therefore, if you build that by yourself, that's also a lot of effort. Definitely can do that. I mean, the products are also built with some of these technologies. But it's really important to understand that this monitoring UI is, again, not just some kind of request response or updates every 1 second or 10 seconds, but it really is the continuous queries are in there, and that's the key difference. And also what's important is that this is not just live UI where you monitor the stuff, but here you then can also do the proactive actions. Like, for example, in the predictive maintenance example, you can, for example, if you see a machine doing errors all and all the time, you can either send a message to the mechanic, for example, that it goes there, or if it's even worse and short before exploding or whatever that is, then you can stop the machine by clicking a button or something like this. From the open source perspective, well, you can build it on your own. Then you use, I think, the typical frameworks, JavaScript frameworks for building the web UI, and some kind of messaging integration like WebSockets. That's probably the best way to do build it by yourself. And there's also, again, commercial offerings on the market like SQL Stream or Zoom Data Stream. That's all newcomers which are built exactly for that. Some of them really run on top of Apache Hadoop or Spark, so natively big data. Or you use things which are combined with the commercial vendors like TIBCO. We have, for example, Live Data Mart, which we by intention named this way. So if you know the Data Mart from the data warehouse, where you do, in the end, take a look backwards as historical data, here with the Live Data Mart, you want to continuously monitor the data. And for that, the characteristics, I think the most important point really is, as I already pointed out, that you really have a continuous query engine under the hood when you want to build your live UI, so that you do not have just refresh or request response, because then many use cases will probably not work perfectly. Let's take shortly a look to relation to other big data components. That's mainly what I showed you in the other session, if you have attended that. So just to give the connection here, it's important to understand that it's nice to have streaming analytics and implement these patterns I showed you, right? So with correlation of the events of different data sources in real time, with sliding windows and so on. But the next question then would be, what do you want to implement? And for that, you somehow have to find some patterns and insights. And therefore, you have to take a look at historical data. So usually, in almost all use cases I have seen, before you want to implement streaming analytics, you first have to find out the patterns. And therefore, you take a look somehow at historical data to find patterns there. And you can do that either with some kind of visualization tool, data discovery, so where you have a business user which takes a look at the live at the UI and connects to data like Hadoop or a data warehouse or CSV files. Or you can here again apply analytic models. And therefore, we have a lot of other sessions here today and tomorrow, how you can build analytic models. And the key really is, when you have built these models here together with a visualization tool and frameworks like R or Apache Spark, ML or H2O or TensorFlow, or whatever you use for your specific use case, the key is then to deploy that analytic model and insight to real-time processing. And therefore, in this screen, you see also that in the blue real-time processing part, you see the red component. That means that you, from the analytics part, from historical data, where you build the insight and patterns, you deploy the same insight and pattern to the real-time processing. And then when you have built that, then you can deploy that, run that to new sensor data or to new social events to analyze that in real-time. Here's just a screen side again to highlight again. First, find the insights with visual analytics, and you need some kind of machine learning under the hood. And then you apply that to real-time processing. That can be a very simple pattern which you program manually, but it's pretty often works. So in financial trading 10 years ago, there was no real machine learning stuff. So here, the rules were defined, and then someone configured it in the tool or programmed it with Java or so. And in the meantime, often you leverage machine learning instead of that to find the patterns. And so let's take a look at the live demo, how that looks like. For that, again, I used a use case from the beginning where we want to scrap parts in an assembly line in a manufacturing use case. And this use case, again, the station one has costs for each part, then the station two has costs. And sometimes you have to do rework in station one, and that costs again. And here the use case simply was to do streaming analytics to decide when to scrap parts as early as possible to reduce the costs. That was mainly the use case. And what we did here, in this case, because this was really complex data which was stored in Hadoop, a lot of different data sources with different data structures and so on, as you see here in blue. And we analyzed that data with our visual analytics tool, as you can see on the bottom in red. And because it was so complex, we needed the help of a data scientist who built an analytic model for that. Because the business user alone could not find insights to do that. And so we built an analytic model where we can save money by helping the model us decide when to scrap a part as early as possible. And when we have built the model, we deployed that to real-time processing. As you see at the top in yellow, here that's exactly the same analytic model which we built before. And in this case, we used H2O AI, which is another open source machine learning framework which leverages Hadoop and Spark under the hood. But the key benefit is that it's very fast, and that's important for Internet of Things, for example, where you have to leverage it for many, many different sensor events, so even thousands or maybe even millions of events later. Then you have to scale it out, and therefore every machine learning framework has its pros and cons here. And in this case, just to show you one example here, where we found a pattern, as you see in the middle, a little bit slow. At this assembly line, we could save, with the random forest analytic model, 97,000 euro. I'm not sure about when, I think it was per month or something like this. And we deployed this model. And therefore, we deployed this model via our, in this case, H2O connector, to deploy that to the real-time processing. And let me show that to you in a minute, how that looks like. So I'm going to my Amazon instance. And this is, again, the same demo from the last talk, but now here I can go into a little bit more detail. And so let's start here. So this is, in the end, such a streaming process which we implemented. And this is all the pipeline which I showed you before. So first, you have some kind of data ingestion. So in this case, this is just a feed simulation now with a file, but usually you have the sensor connected. And in this case, we receive XML data. So that's the proprietary data we received from this customer. It was XML. It's not perfect for high-performance real-time processing, but it was XML. And then we had to do some things like, and we had to parse it, and then we have to filter it. So the typical things we have in such an integration flow. And for each of these components, and therefore I also prefer to show a tool instead of some code, you see how that works. So for each of these activity here, then you have an input, for example, some sensor information, and then you do filtering, and then you have an output afterwards. And that's true for every single activity. And so you do one process after the next in the streaming pipeline. And then, what's also important is then the powerful streaming part. I have here one example where we use Apache Spark ML as analytic model. And one component here, that's the power of analytics, let's say, is the aggregation component. Because here then, you do things like configuring the windows. So here you have things like you really configure exactly how your window should look like. So for example, here I have a window, open every three tuples. So every single stream is a tuple, and we open a new window with every third stream. And then it runs for 10 tuples in this case. And you can configure this as complex as you think. So we have use cases in trading where it's about fraud detection and these kind of use cases. And there's very complex windows where you have to be really a business expert, a subject matter expert in trading to build and monitor these kind of fraud detection models then. But that's the way you do that, either here in the tooling, or if you use a tool like Apache Spark or Flink or so, then you configure that in the code in the end. But you configure somehow these kind of very powerful windows of streaming analytics. And then finally, in this use case, which I'm already running, here is then the H2O component. And here now I also apply my machine learning model in the real-time process. And all this is happening continuously for every single event which is happening. And so let's take a look how that runs. I already started it before the session. So here is my feed simulation, which is running. I can increase it here a little bit. This is now running with test data, so I have not connected a remote source. In the real world, then, of course, it's things like MQTT or JMS or whatever source connects to this. And here now I'm feeding it. And if you take a look at the live UI, let's go here. At the live UI, here it is. So here you see then for every single new event, there is a point coming in. And it's evaluating, in this case, the streaming analytics for every single new event, do we scrap it or not? So the green ones are, no, we do not scrap it because it's under a threshold. And the red ones are, yes, we scrap it because it's over the threshold. And that's decided for every single part in every single and every single station. And important here is also that you do some actions. Actions are the things to configure, like send a mechanic or stop the machine in this case. So it's much more than just monitoring in these tools. You really want to augment the human, let's say, the intelligence. And here, for example, also in the web UI, and here we can also see the performance measurements. And if you take a look at these examples, these are all very fast. And in this case, the complete streaming process I showed you with reading the ingesting the XML messages, with parsing them, with filtering, with aggregation, and with applying the analytic model, in total takes here around 3 milliseconds or something like this. And here, that's the reason, for example, why we used H2O in this example, because this executes very fast and scores very fast. So this takes here around 0.2 milliseconds per event. And if you want to really go there to millions of events, you need this performance here. In other use cases where you do not need the performance, you might use R or Python or another model. That depends on the use case. And with that, let's sum this up, what I showed you. So the key takeaway is streaming analytics, as I explained to you, is really processing data while it is in motion. So if you want to take a look at that, go to the other sessions about Flink and Apex and so on. They will definitely explain that in more detail and how to code that. But the key difference is really that you program in continuous queries and sliding windows. That's a huge difference to the traditional modeling and programming you know until now. And besides that, you often need proactive human interaction, so some kind of live UI on top of that. That's key in many, many projects. And therefore, also, streaming analytics is nevertheless complementary to many other solutions like Apache Hadoop and Apache Spark, machine learning, and so on. Because, again, if you do not have insights and patterns, you do not know what to implement in streaming analytics. So it's usually you start with historical analytics, and then you move forward to that. Okay, and that's it. Do we have time for questions? Yes, okay, two questions or so, if someone has one. I don't see any. Otherwise, you can also always contact me via Twitter, LinkedIn, and so on. I'm happy for any feedback. Okay, thank you a lot.